Page 108, Kuzari. Last week we were discussing the lineage of wisdom, divine wisdom, that went down through the ages. And the last generation of Noach and his wife, Nahama, who fused both worlds together. Right, that's where we left off. We left off on page 108, at paragraph 4. Vefshal. And it was possible. For divinity to skip a generation in this link of descendants. Keterach. Like, who's the most famous? Who's Terach? Very good. Not son. Abraham's father. Very good. But Abraham's father, so if Terach, what did Terach do? Remember what his job was? He was a manufacturer of idols. You can't get further from the divine wisdom than this. But Avraham Avinu, his son, was the one who brought back the belief of Hashem to the masses. So how did this work? If this goes from father to son, so what happened to Avraham? Where did he get it from? Avraham was the disciple of his grandfather Ever. What does it say about Ever?
New Noach.
Very good. Ever, v'od sheisig Noach be'atzmo. He even knew Noach. Who knew Noach?
Ever.
Look at the footnote, 111.
He had the three sons.
Look at the footnote, 111.
Abraham was 58 years old when Noach died.
Abraham was 58 years old when Noach died.
Yeah.
Did Abraham know Noach?
Yeah.
Yes.
Oh, so referring to Abraham, not ever.
Very good. It's misleading. So Avraham Avinu, not just did he get it from Ever, his grandfather, but also he had a direct connection to Noach, who was the father of this whole family.
He was the one connection that passed it after the flood.
Very good.
Without Noah,
very good.
The transmission line would have been broken.
Very good. V'haya hinan Elohi davek bahem ba'avot avotam, el b'nei b'nim. Divinity could therefore pass from grandparents to grandchildren. You'll find this very often in a family. Have you never seen a grandchild that looks like their grandparent? They don't look like their parents necessarily, but they look exactly like their grandmother.
Hmm.
Exactly like their grandfather. Forget look, personality.
Sometimes.
Yeah, you have a person who, you'll see this in all kinds of families. Look at my family. So now my father's a rabbi today. But for many years I was a rabbi. My grandparents were all rabbis, but I was like in this. I came back, so to speak. I came back to the family profession. My mother's father and my father's father were both rabbis. So I was, and then my father today, Baruch Hashem, he also has Micha, so also a rabbi. But you can see that you don't always take just after your parents. There are other influences on a person's life.
Sure.
Grandparents very often can be a big influence on a person's life.
I think I read somewhere that if there's a rabbi in the family, in a family, for three generations, that it stays.
Hi, shalom
alaikum. Right, if there was a what?
That they stay religious, the family.
If there was a,
I read it somewhere that if three generations have rabbis and they stay religious, the family stays basically religious. That they don't fall out of, they don't become secular, they stay religious.
I don't know.
I've read that somewhere, but I don't know.
There is a verse that says, okay. that the knot that is tied with three knots, or the rope that is entwined with three different strings, will not rip very easily. But it could be that's a learning out from that verse, something. Could be. So let's pause right here. So now, Pichas and Leah, they're in our class. But he's not done. The Kuzari continues. V'Avraham hayas gulat ever v'talmido, v'alken nikra Ivri. We call Avraham the Ivri, the Hebrew. Some say it was because he was on the other side of the river. Whatever reasons they give, Rabbi Yehuda Levi says he was not called Avraham ha'Ivri, the Hebrew. Rather, he was called Avraham the Ivri, meaning the student of
ever.
Very good. He was the student of ever. You ever thought about it that way?
I remember hearing a class about this.
Oh, I think we mentioned it once in the Kuzari class, a long time ago.
Really,
yeah, I see if you look Kuzari 149, the footnote on the bottom says. Ve'ever has Gulat Shem. Ever was the descendant of Shem. Ve'shem has Gulat Noach, and Shem was the same thing to Noach. Mipnei shu yoresh ha'aklimim ha'shavim asher emtzaitam v'chemdatam eretz Kanaan admat ha'nevuah. Shem had inherited the temperate climates of the earth, of which the choicest and most temperate was the land of Canaan. Temperate for what? Choicest for what?
Well, probably for food and...
What would that help him with his divine wisdom?
He says no, because it'll give him,
if he can gather the stuff quick, then he has more time to learn Torah.
Okay, that's a novel interpretation.
It says no, it's the soil of prophecy. That's right here.
Known as the soil of prophecy, Admat HaNevuah. So yes, Eretz Yisrael, like Barry mentions, we're going to come to Tu B'Shvat, is known for its Shivat Aminim. It has outstanding, I don't know if you've ever been, when I eat fruits here in America, who will let you? They taste okay. You go to Israel, the taste of a fruit is like a whole different world. The cucumbers in Israel taste like a cucumber. Here they taste like water.
I even tried getting... like Mediterranean cucumber seeds, and they still taste like American cucumbers.
Is it something? It's a davar yadua. It's a known thing. The olives of Israel, the wine of Israel, the grapes of Israel, the pomegranates of Israel. You can't beat us. You can't beat them. Obviously, it's a personal. It's not a personal opinion. It's a Jewish opinion. But I tell that personally, I felt it in my life. But there's something else about Eretz Israel. The Talmud says, "Avirat Eretz Israel machkima." The wind, the spirit, the environment in Israel makes you wiser. They tell a story about a little Israeli boy whose mother sent him to his sister's house with a pot of food for Shabbat. So he's walking down the street, and a passerby says, "Hey, little boy, what's in your pot?" He looks at him and he says, "You know, if my mom wanted you to know what's inside of the pot, she wouldn't have put the lid on it." It makes you smarter, but also in a spiritual way, what you can accomplish. Rabbi Nachman of Breslov writes that the 2 weeks that he spent in Israel, the levels of holiness that he acquired, his entire lifetime outside of Israel, he would never be able to reach. You find stories in the Talmud about rabbis who came from Babel, from Babylon, to Israel. At the border of Israel, they prayed, "Hashem, erase from me everything I know about the Torah from Babylon. I don't want to know it. I just want to know the Torah of Israel." The land of Israel has inside of it a certain segula, a certain elite environment for the study of Torah wisdom. V'yatza Yefet el Tzafon, v'cham el Darom. So Yefet went to the north, and Cham went to the south. This is a machloket Rashi and the Ramban, but it's not our problem. Let's pause here. See, last week, you could have asked a good question, Rabbi Yehuda Levi. And the question is, Rabbi Yehuda Levi, you're telling me it goes from father to son, there's some elite, unbroken chain, it's a holy link that goes all the way back to Adam HaRishon, to the first man who had his own children, one who was wise, one who wasn't, he had another child that was born to replace the other one. We mentioned such a story.
I give you something, it's here.
And he says,
thank you.
He says, the story is a nice story.
Thank you.
But how do you explain? How do you explain Avraham Avinu? His father was the broken link in the chain. So what did Rabbi Yehuda Levi answer? How do you explain Avraham? How did Avraham continue on the torch? How did he continue?
He brought everybody back in.
Who taught him?
Ever.
Very good. So it can skip a generation, but there's still going to be an unbroken chain. And it's for this reason that the people of Shem lived in the land of Israel. Because they knew that this land was special. There was something here, something in this land that was connected to Elohut, to godliness, to Nevuah, to prophecy. So let's ask you a good question. So what gives a person this extra level of internal divine wisdom? Is it where he's born? The location, the land, the environment? Is it inheritance from his father? Is it the temperament of the place? I mean, he doesn't have to be born there, but he can come there. What is it that contributes to this person's growth?
Probably a combination of both.
Very good.
The land and...
There's a combination of many of these factors. And therefore, it's not a surprise to the Kuzari that from all the lands in the world that Shem would inherit, it was specifically this little land of Israel. Well, he wasn't powerful enough to take the rest of the world. He didn't need the rest of the world. You look at the Rambam, Hilchot Mashiach. Maimonides writes, Lo nitavu chachamim, the sages of the Jewish people, did not desire Mashiach to come so they could eat grapes and sip wine all day long, so they could go sit on the beach with a pina colada. Rather, what did they ask for? To sit and study the wisdom of Hashem in the land of wisdom and prophecy. That's all they wanted. Leave us alone. We are not a people who try to conquer the world. We don't want any other country. If you offer me today, hey, take Poland, take Russia, take Yemen, take Morocco, who wants it? Who asked for it? I don't want these countries. Let them keep it. There's no world conquest planned for Jewry. Actually, all we've been trying to do is go home to a piece of land that is barely noticeable on the map. Now, the reason why everyone's fighting over it, they don't know. It's because it is the center of the universe, of wisdom, of intelligence, of divinity in the world. And any nation that conquers this land from the Jewish people, and not just from the Jews, but from Shem, from the people of Shem, so even the precursor to the Jews, those nations, it's a ticking timer for how long they're going to be able to stay there. It's not forever. If the evil of the Jewish people are not able to stay in Israel, like the Torah says, "V'taki ha'aretz," the land will vomit them out, then how much more so people who are not even inclined to evil or good, they have nothing divine about them? The land of Canaan, but they're still around. How many Canaanites do you know? The seven nations that were occupying the land, we don't have them anymore. And the nation now that's there, also they'll disappear. They go everywhere. We don't want to kill them. Just go. There's so many places they could go. But there's something else. Avraham Avinu didn't just have divine wisdom from his grandfather. He also had something in it from his father. It says, mentioned the land of Israel now. And it's segula, it's choiciness for wisdom, for intelligence, for divine Torah. Everything that's holy has a flip side that's equally unholy. According to Kabbalah, you always have Kedusha, and the exact opposite of the Kedusha, you have Tuma, and a certain kind of opposing force. And the more you go in one direction, the more it exists in a different direction. So, for example, when the Halakha tells us that a person who does an Avira outside of the land of Israel has a certain effect on the world, a negative effect. But a person who does a mitzvah inside of the land of Israel has a twofold negative effect. And inside of Jerusalem, another greater effect. Inside of the old city of Jerusalem, next to the Kotel, another effect. And on the Temple Mount, another effect. Inside the Holy Holies, an even deeper effect. So on and so forth. Because the holier you go, the possibility for lack of Kedusha, of holiness, is very high. It goes the other way around, too. The mitzvah that you do here is not comparable to the mitzvah you do there, to the mitzvah you do by the Kotel, to the mitzvah you do... I used to tell my students in Yerushalayim, you have an avirah you want to do? Okay. I'm going to stop you. You're going to listen to me. Just do me a favor, take it outside Yerushalayim. Get on a bus, go somewhere. Oh, the land of Israel also holy? I wish you could take it to New York, but you can't. So for right now, just at least step out of the gates of Jerusalem. At least don't do it when your dorm room sees the Kotel. All kind of person to think. If you want to speak Lashon Hara, who's going to listen to me not to speak Lashon Hara? If you want to speak Lashon Hara, don't do it at Beit Knesset. This place has a holier effect than that. So go to the hallway. You don't go to the bathroom in the Beit Knesset. You can't. Oh, you want to speak Lashon Hara in the Beit Knesset? Fine. But not when the Torah is out. Not when someone is being the Yom Kippurim in the middle of Ne'ilah. That's not when you say Lashon Hara. The person has to know that everything that I have in my life is a big balance. Terach, the fact that Terach was the number one idol-worshipping company in the whole world. I don't know, he's a CEO of Idols Incorporated. I don't know what he had. Avodah Zarah Unlimited.
Idols are us.
Idols are us, yeah?
Artos.
Terach, it didn't come from nowhere. Terach's desire to bring tumah into the world, to bring a lack of holiness into the world, came from his potential for holiness. A person who doesn't have potential for holiness also doesn't have the potential for lack of holiness. sure. The Lubavitcher Rebbe has a long sicha, a long speech that he gave about the story of Chanukah. And if you look in the words of the Al HaNisim, "Utmeim biyat tehorim," and that you allow the impure to fall into the hands of the pure. He mentions this was a civil war. He said the Greeks didn't have the spiritual capability to become pure, and therefore they also didn't have the spiritual capability to become impure. You may not like what I'm telling you now.
But they are impure. They were impure.
They were not impure. They were something else. They were bad, maybe. Impure, they couldn't have that title. We say, Rishaim biyad tzadikim. You gave the evil in the hands of the righteous. The Greeks weren't evil. To be evil, you have to have the ability to be righteous. So who are we talking about? It says the Lubavitcher Rebbe was a civil war between those Jews who wished to go on the path of righteousness and those Jews who wished to Hellenize themselves. Oh, it's a little bit of a different story of Chanukah than they told you in Hebrew school. Probably, I can understand. But there's something to be said here. Terach didn't sell idols because he sold idols because the potential in him was that he could have sold Hashem the same way. But he chose not to go down that road.
Well, how can you say that there weren't Greeks or other people?
There were Greeks.
Who had the potential to be holy, but they didn't. I mean, how do we distinguish between those people who have the potential and those who are just bad?
I'm not taking away from the Greeks the ability to reach a certain level of Kedusha. But the Greeks we were up against in Israel, their definition was void of any kind of spirituality. Even negative spirituality is spirituality. A person with a guilty conscience, every time they do an avera, that is a spiritual experience. If a person hates Hashem, he still has a relationship with Hashem. It's the one who doesn't care, who is completely numb. That person, the relationship is not there. A man who hates his wife still has a relationship with her, a terrible one.
Yeah.
But it's a relationship.
Yeah, it's totally a relationship.
But the moment they get up and go their separate ways and never talk to each other again, that's not a relationship. Yeah, so do we prefer the negative one? I'm not telling you we prefer the negative one. But it still would qualify as a relationship. Negative, but a relationship. Terach had a spiritual experience he was offering the world. Doesn't sound so spiritual to me, it's a bunch of idols. It is a spiritual, it's a negatively spiritual experience, but it is. The person who doesn't believe in any form of God, any divinity, he's not going to sell you idols, he believes it's all nonsense. Just like he wouldn't sell you Hashem. Make sense? Yeah? Okay. And from here, there's a piece in the Talmud in Sanhedrin. It says in Bereshit, can someone bring me a chumash, maybe? Any chumash, doesn't have to be from the new one. Thank you. The famous meeting between Esav and his father Yitzchak. Okay, not about Esav, we're talking about Yaakov Avinu. Yaakov Avinu dresses like Esav. Remember, he goes to get his blessing from Yitzchak?
Mm-hmm.
It says, Vayigash v'yishaklo. He drew close and he kissed him. Vayarach et reach begadav. And he smelled the fragrance, the smell of his clothing. Vayivarcheh, when he blesses him. Vayomer, and he says, Re'e re'ach bani, k're'ach sadeh, asher berchoh Adonai. See, the fragrance of my son is like the fragrance of a field which Hashem had blessed. The Gemara Sanhedrin has a different understanding of this verse. This is obviously not pshat, not the pshat. This is a something we learn out from the verse. Our rabbis say, the word Bigadav is the same letters as the word Bogadav, his rebellion. He smelled the rebellion of his son. He smelled the betrayal. He smelled the trickery. The word Reach can be used positively. A smell can also be a negative smell. Now, fragrance is one thing. Art scrolls translate according to the Pshat, because his fragrance is good. The Talmud says, no, don't read fragrance, say it was a smell. What a smell? What smells? Something which is bad. What causes something to smell bad?
Clean.
Spoiling.
Spoiling. Even when people smell, Khalila, you know, if you know science a little bit, it's parts of a person's body that are breaking down. They're being deteriorating. And that's what causes the smell. Your refrigerator never smells as bad as your garbage can Sunday night when you put it out, because it's been sitting for a week outside, deteriorating. The refrigerator is deteriorating less rapidly. When Yitzchak Avinu smells Yaakov, he smells a deterioration of character. Now, I told you, put aside everything you know. I'm not here to complain about Yaakov Avinu. But there was a certain... something was wrong here. There was something that should not be happening here, and yeah, Yitzchak Avinu could sense it with his smell. Terach, he smelled of idol worship. But the reason he smelled was because he had something to deteriorate. He had a lofty soul that was inside of him that he could have used for a great potential, but he chose not to, and therefore his soul was deteriorating. And in order to get his high, his a person still has to feel a sense of accomplishment, of doing something big for the world. His job was supposed to be to bring holiness to the world, but it wasn't. And instead, he brought to the world a lot of greatness, a great idol worship, in ways that was unprecedented. Terach was, it was like a factory, it was a mission, it was his goal, was to put these idols everywhere. Because he had the same potential to do good. And if you look at the Jews, who've had a great effect in the world, there are many Jews, unfortunately, who are not such good people. What did I just last night? My wife showed me a picture of, forgive me if my history is not so up to date, Lenin Trotsky, could it be?
Oh, yeah.
He's a Jewish guy, no?
Both of them.
He was killed in Mexico City.
Right. Trotsky, he had a Jewish name, like Levi Dov or something like that. This person who was part of a regime that didn't do such good to the world.
Yeah. So I say it lightly. Lenin, so you had to run.
But do you understand that this understanding, this, how did he come? How did he affect the world so much? There's some philosophers that were Jewish people, like
Spinoza.
Very good one. In him in our classes, he had the potential to be a great man, a student of Rabbi Menashe ben Israel, who's going to be my book Bezrat Hashem. But he chose to go down a very different road. Who else?
Albert Einstein was considered much of a philosopher.
Right. I wouldn't blame Einstein for being necessarily wicked in his beliefs. I don't know what he was exactly. I've heard conflicting reports about Einstein and religion. So I'm going to leave him as I don't know. Who else?
Karl Marx.
Yeah?
Definitely left a mark on the world.
I don't know if it was a good one. Yeah. I'm sure his fans will disagree with me. But from our perspective, it wasn't a good mark on the world. Wherever there's a potential for greatness and influence to the world, look at Yeshu. You have half of this planet believes that a Jewish guy is their God.
Yeah.
Who died on a cross to save them. It tells you two things. One is that the half of the world is a very gullible nation. But the other thing it tells you, it makes sense for the world to believe that if there were some man who was going to be God, he would be Jewish. We mentioned that in the Kuzari class a long time ago.
He also mentioned it in a Monday morning class, because I was just listening.
Oh, right. I didn't mention it. It's just true.
Or Yom Kippur.
And I don't know if you remember there, Rav Uri Sharkey gave a whole explanation. That the same God that was Jewish, they also had in their theology to kill him. Is a certain respect but hate that exists at the same time. Which actually, if you know a little bit of philosophy, Freud had such a belief. About a person, his father and his mother. Nonsense doesn't have to be repeated all the time. But he had such a belief. Same thing here. Wherever you see potential for greatness, Yeshu could have been that person. I don't know him. I never met the guy. He could have brought 1 billion people to the world as Jews. Or not as Jews. We're not looking for recruits. But he could have at least brought the world to belief in one God. He could have brought to the world values of greatness, of goodness, of depth. But instead he chose to use the one guy who was in the times of the Talmud and nobody. The rabbis dedicate a few paragraphs to him. He wasn't even worth the paper that they wrote on. But look at the mark he left in the world. You can't take it away from him. He's a person who must have had potential for greatness and chose to use it for evil ways. But I wanted to tell you one more thing. And we started a few minutes late, so forgive me if we just read one more paragraph together. Oh, thank you. Uzgulat Avraham ibanav Yitzchak. Who was Avraham's main disciple? Descent was Yitzchak. He had Ishmael too. But what did he do? He chiket kol banav meharitz hazot ha-mesugelet. He distanced all his other children, not just Ishmael, but he had many other children. That he distanced, remember, he sends them to the east and he gives them gifts. Remember this verse from the Torah? He doesn't want them to stay in this land. Kedei shetiyeh miyuchedet liYitzchak. Because he needs this land to remain pure, to remain uncompromised. He needs an environment here to be fitting for prophecy, for growth. Uzgulat Yitzchak Yaakov, Yitzchak had Yaakov. V'nitcha Esav achiv mipnei shezacha Yaakov be'eretz ahi. And Esav also had to go because Yaakov Avinu deserves this land. Uvnei Yaakov, and what about Yaakov's children? He had how many children? 12 and a girl? 13. Kulam segulayu. They were all, it wasn't just one son anymore, one child. All of them. Yaakov Avinu reached a whole new height. Kulam ruim l'yan ha'elohi. They were all fit for divine wisdom. V'ayah lehem ha'makom mahu ha'miyuchad b'yan ha'elohi. Therefore they all inherited this land that was reserved for divinity. V'zah ya t'chilat chul ha'inyan ha'elohi al kahal. This was the first time where there began a new era, where the divine presence rested on a community of people. Marlene, you asked me about this last week. You find that the first time in history where it didn't go from one person to the next, went from one person to a group of people. Yaakov Avinu's children weren't just children. They had spouses, they had their own children, and they all were included now into this category of people who were able to have the divine presence rest on them. Because until now it was only rested on individuals. And Hashem preserved them and caused them to multiply. He raised them in Egypt. Kasher yigdal ha'ilan asher shoshot tov. Waiting like a tree which has good roots. What was he waiting for? Ad she'otzi pri shalem. Domeh lepri harishon asher nita mimeno. They're waiting for him to have the same fruit that originally was. Meaning they're waiting for a certain quality to develop in this tree of Israel. רוצה לומר, אברהם, יצחק ויעקב, יוסף ואחיו, יוסף and his brothers. והיה מן הפרי, משה ואהרון ומרים, and from that fruit came out משה and Aaron, and not just men, remember we're mentioning Dina was already from the 13 children? And מרים, who was a prophetess. וכמו בצלל ואוליאב, and בצלל and אוליאב. וכמו ראשי המטות ושבעים הסקנים, אשר היו ראויים לנבואה מתמדת. And you had all the elders, and you had all the chiefs of the staff, of the tribes. Yehoshua ben Nun v'Chalev ben Yefune. You had Yehoshua and Caleb. Remember the two who were good out of the 12 spies? V'Chur, Bunah shel Miriam. Chur, remember Chur? He was the son of Miriam. V'Zulatam Rabim. There were many other such people. V'Az hayu ruim leharot or aleihem v'Hashgacha hi haribonit. So now you understand a little bit more about what happened at the sea. That even the maidservant on the sea saw a certain prophecy. You see what happens when the Torah comes out? There's a time in history where Hashem feels that it's not just a single person's inheritance. There's now a nation, there's a community, there's a people who deserve for Hashem to be resting in them entirely. I'll obviously go back next week and read this whole thing in depth. I want to finish a point. And if there were any of them who were mamrim, they were rebels, they were sinners. They were nigalim. They were rejected. Achem blisavek zgula, but they were nonetheless from the descendants who could have had potential for greatness. Kasher hem betoldotam v'tivam min hazgula, because in their roots, in their nature, they are part of these chosen descendants. V'yulidu mi sheyes zgula, they have the ability, even a person who's so far away, has the ability to give birth to a child who is a completely different person. We have many such people in our history. They were not such great people, but their children came out. It was incredible. ונזהרים באב הממרה בעבור מה שיתערב בו מן הסגולה אשר תראה בבנו או בבן בנו. This is why sometimes a wicked person will be spared. Why will be spared? The Zohar says. It's a piece of Zohar. I wish I could take it and put it on everybody's wall. The Zohar says, could you imagine? Could you imagine if we would have prayed for Terach to pass away? Someone would have been in that generation. Right, just say, Terach, such an evil man. I don't want this son. I don't want this brother. I don't want this uncle. I don't want this cousin. They pray for him to die. So you wouldn't have Avram. You wouldn't have Yitzchak. You wouldn't have Yaakov. You wouldn't have David. You wouldn't have the King Messiah. If someone would have prayed for Terach to die, there's no more wicked man, and Hashem would have answered, we wouldn't be in this room. None of us. Oh, so sometimes they go, so why is a wicked person surviving? Why is a wicked person? You don't know who this wicked person will be. Haman. What does it say about Haman? Is there a more wicked person than Haman?
No.
Haman, the Talmud says about him, what are we saying in Gemara Tzu? Rov banav v'kinyanav. The majority of his sons were hung on a tree. Majority. The Talmud says Haman had 70 children.
70?
So the guy was all over the place. Not with one woman, don't worry. I mean, worry. That was Haman. Haman was a filthy, loathsome human being. But from the descendants of Haman, Bnei Banav, his grandchildren, the children of his children, Lamdu Torah b'Bnei Brak. Says the Talmud, they studied Torah in B'nei Brak. Haman! Haman HaRasha, the evil Haman, had grandchildren that sat and studied Torah b'Nei Brak? There was a lady who used to study by my mother. A righteous person. I don't know if she converted or if her mother was Jewish and her father wasn't. I don't know. A very special person. Her father was a KGB agent. His job was to hunt down Jews on the streets.
Oh, yeah.
Wow.
And she raises her kids in a Jewish lifestyle, the Jewish school, goes to the Bet Knesset. Do you believe such a thing? You never know. Someone says, oh, how come this person is around? Do you know what Hashem knows? Yeah. Someone told me a quote. It wasn't a Jewish quote, but a special quote. That was maybe Rachel told us. And Shabbat. She said, from, I believe it was Rabbi Pesach Kron. I want to remember all the names. It says in the Talmud that if you quote something from the person who said it, you bring redemption to the world. Who do you learn that from? Who taught that rule? That you have to quote in the name of someone who told you?
You.
Not from me. Thank you, Marlene. I flattered.
Well, it's in Perkiyavo. Well, I mean, it doesn't say why, but there's a lot of reference.
Why is the Talmud so particular? I'm not going to be Benjamin in the name of this one, in the name of that one, in the name of the third one. Why?
So you may get merit of their greatness.
Esther HaMalka comes to Ahasuerus. Vatomer, and she says, B'shem Mordechai, in the name of Mordechai. And once she says that, Mordechai told me. That's when the redemption came. Mm-hmm. And the Talmud says, Kol ha'omer davar b'shem omo, anybody who says something in the name of the person who said it, mevi ge'ula la'olam, brings about redemption to the world. It brings a goodness to the world. The Lubavitch Rebbe once said, I didn't see him say it. I saw a chassid of his right. The Lubavitch Rebbe knew that many people didn't appreciate his name being quoted. Kind of like Rav Kook. People don't like when you say Rav Kook. And so the Lubavitch Rebbe said that if I say something and it's profoundly important, it can help a person, and you know that they'll reject what I'm saying because it has my name on it, don't use my name. Say that you came up with it. Or don't lie. Just say, there was once a great rabbi who said, don't mention my name. It will have a negative effect. You only mention someone's name if it's going to have a positive effect. It doesn't have to be this way. And so we continue. Rachel, I was going to tell what she told me. She said the name of Pesach Kron, that every person can count how many seeds are in an apple.
Oh, yeah.
But only Hashem can count how many apples are inside of one seed.
Yeah.
Oh.
Hashem can look at Terach and say, look who's going to come out of Terach. So you are counting. Hashem, in my world, with my vision, this is what I see. Why is that person so great and this person is so wicked and look at how their lives look? I don't know. I'm not sure. Guys, there's psukim in the Torah that I don't understand. There are commentaries on the Talmud that I don't know how to read properly. I can't read a man-made book that was 300 years old. Hashem, you want me to understand? I don't know. A little bit of humility will never take a person. I've never hurt a person.
Actually, it was a Revitzin that Rabbi Pesach Kron was quoting.
Oh, so Barry's bringing even more redemption to the book. Okay, thank you for that. So, let's continue. We're just finishing up this section until we're almost done. Because why does Hashem allow for these people to persevere? Because you don't know. Maybe his son or his grandson will come out righteous. Maybe that drop will come out to be more pure. כמו שאמר בתרח וזולתו מי שלא נדבק בעניין הרי אך בשורש תולדתו שיוליד סגולה מה שלא היה כן בתולדת כל הנולד מחב ויפת. Nevertheless, because of their elite ancestry, they sired elite descendants. But this quality existed only in this pedigree and did not exist in the pedigree of Ham and Yafet. So you find that there is innately inside of these people a potential. Potential doesn't mean that they're better. I once told you that somebody asked Rav Shach, why did we make a blessing, Hashem? Thank you for not creating me a non-Jew. Make a positive blessing. Hashem, thank you for creating me Jewish. And Rav Shach said, what, you think you were created Jewish? So nobody was created Jewish. You were created not Jewish. You want to be Jewish? It takes a lot of work to be Jewish. You're, no one's born into this, I'm a certain pedigree, I'm a certain... You are a good-for-nothing person. You also happen to not be Jewish. Good for you. Just because you are born to a Jewish family doesn't make you deserving of a certain pedigree. It might mean that you have a closer potential. Maybe it's not going to be as difficult for you to reach that level. You know, there's no greater frustration for a person who's converting to Judaism, or has converted, to see Jews that have it already and they don't even know the first thing about it. They don't even know which direction to hold a chumash. They've never been to synagogue in their life. So I have to work hard, but this is good for nothing. You can consider himself Jewish. And they're right. They're right. But at the end of the day, it's like a seed. Every seed, you don't know what's going to come out of it. And it's only for that reason, so to speak, that Hashem tolerates certain individuals because of who may continue to come out of this lineage of their family tree. This phenomenon occurs in genetics as well, and in nature. How many people do you find a son doesn't resemble a parent, but he comes out looking like a grandfather? And obviously the father had this recessive gene. You know a little bit of science. Recessive and dominant genes. So it could be that none of the parents had blue eyes, but they had a recessive gene of blue eyes. And they marry somebody who also had and that gene becomes a dominant gene, and the grandchild has blue eyes. Oh, maybe he's a mamzer. He's not a mamzer. He has a grandfather, a great grandfather. Who knows where the gene comes from? But that gene comes out. It's a davar yadua. There are many such things in the world. ואף על פי שלא נראה להרגשה, כאשר היה צפון טבע עבר בבניו, עד שנראה באברהם, so too Ever's genetics lay dormant in his children until they surfaced again with Abraham. So they skipped Terach, not entirely, but Abraham was the one who brought it out. So maybe on an ending note. The question against Rabbi Halevi, and the feeling against Rabbi Halevi has always been, he seems to be a racist. He does.
Really?
Yeah, sure, you're living in the world of 2016, a 5-7-7-5-6. You have to say, how can you say that one person, just because of where they were born or who they were born to, that makes them the choicest, the elitist? The answer of Rabbi Halevi, he doesn't have to answer. Let me tell you, what is a racist? A Nazi says, Aryans. They have to be blonde hair and blue eyes, and if not, we kill them. He's a racist. How does somebody become an Aryan?
You are.
You don't. When Yimach Shema Mezicham, the KKK, an incredible thing, I just read an article, that the KKK is opening up their branches to people who are not white.
Really?
Yeah. They're trying to recruit because they're running out of numbers. I just can't believe such a thing. I'm talking about it's a real story. It wasn't like in the fake magazine. Maybe someone pulled a prank on me. It could be. I'm sometimes that gullible.
Not to believe their numbers.
But it seems like their numbers were dwindling, so they decided, let's recruit another nation against, I don't know who they hate, against the Mexicans. We'll find someone else who doesn't like them, and we'll join forces. The enemy of my enemy is my friend. That kind of, listen, what do you want from them? They're not intelligent enough to, that's who they are. The KKK. They hate all kinds of people. So how does a black person become part of the KKK?
He doesn't.
He can't.
He can't,
and therefore, he'll never be able to, he'll always be killed or have crosses burned on his lawn or whatever you machshava. I'm telling you, the disgusting people in the world. So we say that the people of Am Yisrael have inside of them a soul that has the potential to become part of the divine wisdom. So tell me, how does a Muslim, or a Christian, or a Buddhist, or a Hindu, how do they become part of the Jewish people?
To convert.
Can they convert to Judaism?
Yeah.
So we're not a race. We're not a race. This doesn't have to be a father to son genetics. Rather, any person in the world who chooses to be part of this Koach Elohi, this divine presence, is able to do so without any kind of differentiation or distinction. And that is why Rabbi Yehuda Halevi is not a racist. He's not telling you that nobody else can be a part of it. The fact is, the history goes on, you see, our Mashiach, our Messiah, the son of David HaMelech, comes from Ruth. Not only was she a convert, but she converted from one of the nations that wasn't allowed to convert to Judaism. Yeah. That's who our Redeemer is? That's who we pray for 100 times a day? Yes, because we're not racists. Everybody can join the club. Everybody can. It takes some hard work, so it takes hard work for Jews to join the club too. How many prophets do you have in your family? All right, so for Jews it's also difficult, but we have the potential. And other people also have the potential. And it's perhaps this reason that drives the Midrash Tanchuma, or the rabbis of the Talmud, to say that every person who converts must mean that part of his soul was on Mount Sinai. Because for them, this is such an innately deep part of their personality that it must be that they, once upon a time, they had this recessive gene inside of them that's still there, lays dormant, and now they're rekindling, kind of like Avraham Avinu himself did. And Bezalat Hashem, Hashem should know, it's not a race. We're not saying that one people are better than the other, but one people are dedicated to bringing divine wisdom to the world, and history shows for itself, from all the nations in the world, which is the only nation that has dedicated itself entirely to bringing divine wisdom to the world. And Bezalat Hashem, we should see that not only do we continue on our path, but many other people decide that this is the path that they want to go to also. And God willing, we should see the Geulah come very, very soon.